Good morning all. So the today lecture basically, which is the lecture number 32, based on the mechanics of the force generation on the tires. So in the previous lecture that we actually discussed about the tire configuration, what are the various tire characteristics are there. Now here we are talking about what are the various forces basically acting on the tire and what basically it affects. So first of all, when we are talking about the mechanics of the tire, so various forces are actually there. That forces are actually in the longitudinal direction as well as in the lateral direction. So the lateral force we already studied in the previous unit, that is Fy, that is the lateral force is there, and the longitudinal force is also acting at there. So due to these forces, some stress has been induced. That stress basically known as the shear stress. The shear stress basically representing here the same. So that means it is actually distributed near to the contact patch. So what is the contact patch? The contact patch basically representing where the contact region has been occurred between the road and the tire. So what type of stress has been induced here? So that is the two types of stresses are there, either it is a shear stress as well as a normal stress. That means both stress has been induced at an oblique plane. So maybe plane at any angle. So that stress has been induced. So here we are talking about the resultant. Resultant means the addition of these two in a resultant manner that will give you the overall stress acting over the tire. As well as if we are talking about the distribution of the pressure, the tire distribution pressure will not be uniform in nature, so it will vary. So it will alter in x as well as in the y direction. So when we are talking about which is actually non-uniform in nature, so due to that one, there is some unsymmetrical type of region will be there. So read this. So when we are talking about the rolling condition, in that situation, so the distribution of pressure which is actually not uniform in nature is specifically in the y direction, that means in the lateral direction. So due to that one, it tends to be a higher in the forward region of the contact patch. So this is the representation here for the load acting on the tire either in the x direction and y direction. That means it is not mandatory always be a uniform. There will be a non-uniform type of pressure distribution will be there. So due to that non-distribution pressure, some forces basically will act. So we already know what is a tire. Tire is actually a viscoelastic material. So the deformation basically occurred near to the contact patch. So due to that contact patch, there is some vertical pressure basically acting on that tire. So due to that vertical pressure, it is actually moving towards the forward direction. So I'll show you a figure that representing the same thing. So two figures we are able to see here. That is one first for the rolling one and second one for the stationary condition. The two conditions we are able to see. When vehicle is in motion and the vehicle is at the rest condition. So this is representing the distribution of pressure when the vehicle is at static condition at the contact patch. So this is the contact patch. Same reason, this is the contact patch. You can able to see here the distribution of pressure which is actually not uniform. So here pressure will be higher, here the pressure will be higher, and here the pressure will be lower. That means when the vehicle moving in the front direction, the pressure distribution will not be uniform. So that you should keep in mind, the distribution pressure, it is actually non-uniform, but for the calculation point of view, we actually assuming the pressure distribution is actually uniform in a some specific area. So here the second point which is very important here, the centroid of the vertical forces. Due to that pressure, some forces basically acting on that one. That forces basically it is actually not passing at the spin axis. Spin axis means there is an axis of the spin, that means the hub of that tire. So it is actually not passing of that spin axis. So due to that one, some forces or some resistance forces that has been generated, that force basically known as a rolling resistance. So some rolling resistance basically acts, that is actually due to the eccentric has been occurred of these forces, which is actually passing somewhere else instead of passing at the spin axis. So when the tires start rolling, some forces basically acting, what are these forces? It is actually known as a traction force or the tractive force, and the second one is the lateral forces. So due to these two forces, some shear mechanism has been occurred. So we already discussed this shear mechanism and the tire. Shear mechanism specifically deform the side walls of the tire that we already discussed in the previous chapter. So you can refer the previous lecture to go through the same thing, what is the shear mechanism here. So when we are talking about what type of the failure has been occurred here, the failure basically occurred, that means I am talking about in terms of stresses, that is our shear stress, it can be a normal stress. So we generally interest about the resultant stress, that means a combination of these two. So these two are basically occurred because the forces developed due to the shear mechanism. So when we are talking about the stress induced over that complete plane, it is either it is because of the traction force or either because of the lateral force, or it can be the combination of these two. So any these two conditions can be add on, it can be individual, can affect the at the contact area. So that we already discussed, this is the representation of the dynamic as well as the stationary condition. Now you are able to see the few terminologies that is very common while defining the mechanism of the force animation, that B basically representing the breaking force basically acting here in the opposite direction, that means in the opposite direction of the motion. F representing the tire rebound force. So this is the tire rebound force you are able to see. M representing here the realignment torque. So that means the alignment torque, that means the, when the tire actually taking a turn. So what is the realignment torque is, if you are giving some steering. M Y representing the camber angle or camber torque. So this is the camber torque. M Y representing the camber torque. N is nothing, it is a distance from the resultant force in the vertical axis. So this is the resultant force axis and this is the vertical axis. The distance from this point to this point is representing the small n. P I is nothing, it is representing the pressure in the tire. Q representing the resultant force. So this is the resultant force. What is this resultant force? This is the force actually acting in terms of resultant of braking as well as next one is the lateral force. So these two force resultant actually acting, this is Q. R representing the wheel load. What is the wheel load? Which is actually the load carrying by in terms of reaction, that is R. Or we can also say R is representing the normal load. R dyne basically representing the dynamic tire radius. The when the tire actually taking a turn or due to some deformation, the dynamic radius will be there. The radius will not be uniform while running, it will be different. So that is representing a dynamic tire radius. S is the lateral force that we already discussed previously. V naught representing the road speed, that means at which speed the vehicle actually moving. Alpha representing the slip angle. So we already know what a slip angle. This is a slip angle, that means the angle between the heading and the travel direction. Beta representing the angle of the resultant force. So this is the resultant force with respect to this vertical axis, that angle basically representing what? The beta angle. I can also measure in this direction. As well as gamma representing the camber angle. So this is the camber angle. So you already know what is my positive camber and what is my negative camber. Accordingly, we actually discuss. So now next we're talking about here, what are the various primary mechanisms we use in terms of force generation. So the primary mechanism of the generation of the traction force because of the friction, we generally know. So here the two mechanisms we are talking about here. The first mechanism is the adhesion, that is also known as a self-adhesion, and the second one is known as a hysteresis. So due to these two mechanisms, it starts some traction force. So how basically it works? First of all, we are talking about the surface adhesion. Surface adhesion basically arises due to the intermolecular bond between the rubber and the road surface, or we can say the aggregate in the road surface. So due to that one, some adhesion has been created. Due to that adhesion, traction force generated and the vehicle start moving in the forward direction. So the main component here because of the road condition. So road condition, if it is a drier in nature, the adhesion component will be maximum one. If the road is at actually wet condition, the adhesion will be very lesser. That means the chances of slipping will be higher. So in that situation, the loss of friction has to be generated. This is the first mechanism. Second mechanism, we're talking about the hysteresis. Hysteresis friction or hysteresis mechanism. Hysteresis basically representing due to some lag, the effect will not, that means the effect will get changed. So that means due to some issues, that means suppose if I'm talking about the hysteresis mechanism, it representing there is a loss in the terms of energy while taking a turn. So due to that loss, it start deforming while sliding over the aggregate or while sliding over the road. So that means this is representing hysteresis. So hysteresis friction is not affected by the water, but it will increase the better traction over the wet surface, because at wet surface they actually having a high hysteresis rubber. So it is actually totally based on the tread of the tire. So both adhesion and hysteresis friction depends not only on the tire condition, but it is also depending upon the amount of slip has been occurred on the tire as well as the road surface. Now the next one, what other forces basically acting? So when we're talking about the other forces, so we generally know when the tire start rotating, some vibration has been generated. So these vibration also plays an important role while calculating the mechanics of all the forces generated over the tire. So first very common force is the tire vibration. So when we're talking about a tire vibration, it is actually generating a force due to the friction. So how this vibration be generated? That means while doing braking as well as a turning operation, that means while accelerating and while braking. So with regard of this, dynamics of the system has to be generated. So we previously discussed this in unit number one. We generally considered a tire as like a spring element, so that absorb the shocks because of the roughness in the road or roughness over the ground surface. So what are the various functions of the tire that can affect the, that means that work as like a cushioning effect that absorb the shocks over the uneven road. Same manner, it will move very smoothly by considering the vertical motions of a body between the sprung mass. Okay, so we already discussed this, the sprung mass and unsprung mass. What is sprung mass? The mass, the body weight, including, that means above the tire portion, above the chassis portion, that all are actually considered as a sprung mass. And unsprung mass, it means apart from the chassis, rest, both are actually not considering the suspension, that is actually coming in the category of the unsprung mass. The same manner here. So read this line. With regards to the ride dynamic, it is seen to behave primarily as a spring which absorbs the roughness of the features in the road and interact with the vertical motion by body and the unsprung muscles. Here we are talking about the tire. When the tires start moving, some vibration generated. So when we are talking about a vibration generated, that means some resonance condition has been generated. So what is resonance? Resonance means when the natural frequency coincides with the external frequency. At that situation, the amplitude becomes excessively very large in nature. So at that situation, it becomes very drastic condition, that means where vibrations start producing. So we need to identify how much resonance it will impact and how this resonance basically change the tire shape. So here this you are able to see a general type of tire. It is actually assumed as like a spring element. So this is the model of the tire, as I have taken this picture. That is representing a loaded radial runout and free radial runout. That means it is representing the in terms of tire terminologies here. Now, when we are talking about a tire vibration, so tire vibration actually occurred or that has been observed in terms of modes of vibration. What are the modes of vibration? Basically, the modes of vibration basically representing what is the behavior of the components or the tire when the frequency has been increased from one phase to another phase. Suppose we are talking about at the first mode. First mode is also known as the lowest mode of frequency. At lowest mode, how much frequency can be generated? So when we see at the first mode, it is only changing the direction in the vertical direction only. When we are talking about the second mode, you can see that it is changing in lateral as well as in longitudinal direction. So this is representing here some frequencies. The general frequency of the passenger car we generally consider as 60 Hz. Then after 90 Hz for the second mode, and third mode it is the 110 Hz. So these are the some data has been taken from the references. So these modes basically representing here how tires start feeling and how tire basically behaves at a different frequency. So these you are able to see at four different frequency what are the behavior of the tire size or tire shape. Here you can see at first frequency it is size is circular in nature, but it is actually moving in a compliance. That means some eccentric condition has been generated. At second frequency, you can see it actually creating a oval type or elliptical type of shape. At third frequency, it will creating a triangular. So triangular means you can see the tire initially it was a circular nature. Now due to that high frequency, the tire's cross section will get changed at high speed, or due to at high speed, the frequency will be very higher in nature. So here again, the concept of resonance will be there. Same situation for the fourth mode. That means the fourth harmonic condition here. So the same thing has been written here. The first mode it will occur where near 60 Hz for the passenger car that involves a simple vertical motion. Second one, there is an elliptical shape and top and bottom threads are always moving up, down, out of the phase. In a similar manner for the next third and the higher order resonance, it is very very drastic in situation. So that means we need to identify the same. So this will end you the lecture. So if any doubt you have, then let me know. We will discuss on the LPO live app, and thank you.